We're going to read first. Some of you might have, so you can sort of share, or otherwise just listen to the words. Because it's a very special, blessed time, Munlam, the prayer festival, I think it is one of Lama Tsongkhapa's traditions in Tibet, which we're doing here every night, different practices, or some nights doing practices. And so we're going to read here chapter one of marvelous Shantideva's text, The Benefits of Bodhicitta. So if you haven't got a copy, just think of the meaning. Think of the meaning. Remembering that for Buddha, every thought counts because every thought goes in. Thought, intention means karma. So every thought you put in the mind, you're programming your mind with that. So be very delighted just to even listen. You know, just listen. Okay. So respectfully, I prostrate myself to the Sugatas who are endowed with the Dharmakaya as well as to their noble sons and to all who are worthy of veneration. Here I shall explain how to engage in the vows of the Buddha's sons, the meaning of which I have condensed in accordance with the scriptures. There's nothing here that has not been explained before, and I have no skill in the art of rhetoric. Therefore, lacking any intention to benefit others, I write this in order to acquaint it to my mind. For due to acquaintance with what is wholesome, the force of my faith may for a short while increase because of these words. If, however, these words are seen by others equal in fortune to myself, it may be meaningful to them. Leisure and endowment are very hard to find. And since they accomplish what is meaningful for man, if I do not take advantage of them now, how will such a perfect opportunity come about again? Just as a flash of lightning on a dark, cloudy night for an instant brightly illuminates all, likewise in this world, through the might of Buddha, a wholesome thought rarely and briefly appears. Hence, virtue is perpetually feeble, the great strength of evil being extremely intense, and except for a fully awakened mind, by what other virtue will it be overcome? All the Buddhas who have contemplated for many eons have seen it to be beneficial. For by it the limitless masses of beings will quickly attain the supreme state of bliss. Those who wish to destroy the many sorrows of their conditioned existence, those who wish all beings to experience a multitude of joys, and those who wish to experience much happiness should never forsake the awakened mind. The moment an awakened mind arises in those fettered and weak in the jail of cyclic existence, they will be named a son of the Sugatas and will be revered by both men and gods of the world. It is like the supreme gold-making elixir, for it transforms the unclean body we have taken into the priceless jewel of a Buddha form, therefore firmly sees this awakening mind. Since the limitless mind of the sole guide of the world has upon thorough investigation seen its preciousness, all beings wishing to be free from worldly abodes should firmly take hold of this precious awakening mind. All other virtues are like the plantain tree, for after bearing fruit they simply perish. But the perennial tree of the awakening mind unceasingly bears fruit and thereby flourishes without end. Like entrusting myself to a brave man when greatly afraid, by entrusting myself to this awakened mind, I shall be swiftly liberated, even if I have committed extremely unbearable evils. Why then do the conscientious not devote themselves to this? Just like the fire at the end of an age, it instantly consumes all great evil. Its unfathomable advantages were taught to the disciple Suddhana by the wise Lord Maitreya. In brief, the awakening mind should be understood to be of two types, the mind that aspires to awaken and the mind that ventures to do so. As is understood by the distinction between aspiring to go and actually going, so the wise understand in turn the distinction between these two. Although great fruits occur in cyclic existence from the mind that aspires to awaken, an uninterrupted flow of merit does not ensue as it does with the venturing mind. And for him who has perfectly seized this mind with the thought never to turn away from totally liberating the infinite forms of life, from that time hence, even while asleep or unconcerned, a force of merit equal to the sky will perpetually ensue. For the sake of those inclined towards the lesser vehicle, this was logically asserted by the Tathagata himself in the sutra requested by Subahu. If even the thought to relieve living creatures of merely a headache is a beneficial intention endowed with infinite goodness, then what need is there to mention the wish to dispel their inconceivable misery, wishing every single one of them to realize boundless good qualities? Do even fathers and mothers have such a benevolent intention as this? To the gods and sages, does even Brahma have it? If those beings have never before even dreamed of such an attitude for their own sake, how would it ever arise for the sake of others? This intention to benefit all beings, which does not arise in others, even for their own sake, is an extraordinary jewel of the mind, and its birth is an unprecedented wonder. How can I fathom the depths of the goodness of this jewel of the mind, the panacea that relieves the world of pain and is the source of all its joy? If merely a benevolent intention excels venerating the Buddhas, then what need it to mention striving to make all beings, without exception, happy? Although wishing to be rid of misery, they run towards misery itself. Although wishing to have happiness, like an enemy, they ignorantly destroy it. For those who are deprived of happiness and burdened with many sorrows, it satisfies them with all, dispels all suffering, and clears away confusion. Where is there a comparable virtue? Where is there even such a friend? Where is there merit similar to this? If whoever repays a kind deed is worthy of some praise, then what need to mention the bodhisattva who does good without its being asked of him? The world honours as virtuous a man who sometimes gives a little plain food disrespectfully to a few beings that satisfies them for only half a day. What need to be said then of one who eternally bestows the peerless bliss of the Sugatas upon limitless numbers of beings, thereby fulfilling all their hopes? The Buddha has said that whoever hears an evil thought against a benefactor, such as that bodhisattva, will remain in hell for as many eons as there were evil thoughts. But if a virtuous attitude should arise in that regard, its fruits will multiply far more than that. When bodhisattvas greatly suffer, they generate no negativity. Instead, their virtues naturally increase. I bow down to the body of him who, in whom the sacred precious mind is born. I seek refuge in that source of joy who brings to happiness even those who harm him. Well, we can't get better than that for a motivation, can we? But in order to get anywhere near this, you know, I mean, we think about emptiness and then we think about bodhicitta, and somehow emptiness excites us and bodhicitta comes sort of like cute and nice, like a good heart and all this. But actually bodhicitta scares the life out of me. I think it's far more heavy. It's far more scary. It's far more difficult. Emptiness, I think, is easy in comparison. I mean, you read those eight verses, you know, we say that these words sound so easy because they're intellectually not complicated. We think it's easier, but it seems to me, I don't know what the teachings say, but it seems to me this is too much, you know. If you start to really read about bodhicitta, and where you, so this is why, too, it's so important when we hear the different teachings, you know, we should, it's so, this marvellous packaging that the Tibetans have put together of Buddha's teachings, coming from Atisha in the 11th century, you know, this, and especially, you know, that Lama Tsongkhapa runs with, the 14th century lineage Lama, our lineage Lama. This amazing structure of all the teachings, you know, from beginning to end, from A to Z, which is, of course, which is translated, Lam Rim is translated as gradual path. Well, you know, that's a very nice arcane 14th century concept. We would translate it in modern terms as a course, wouldn't we? The moment you say you're doing a course, we get it instantly. You know, that's nicely organized material by the kind people who know it already, and they've structured it from beginning to end, from the easiest to the most difficult, and you graduate at the end. Well, that's what the Lam Rim is, you know? So when we understand that bodhicitta is in like university stage, it's at the university level. So there's no way in the universe we can get anywhere near this. We can start with the aspiration. Until we've got some of the first stages, you know, I like to call it junior school and high school, the first and second scopes of the Lam Rim, which is, you know, this is where karma is. This is where karma is, like Buddha's fundamental kind of instructions about the way the universe works, you know. So, okay, here we've talked, the topic of the course is in the context of emptiness, how understanding karma as an example of dependent arising is the king of logics, as Lama Yeshe paraphrases Tsongkhapa, to prove emptiness. But let's just look at it from the practical point of view, or even let's look at it from the point of view as a basis for getting bodhicitta, you know. I mean, I remember His Holiness often would say, compassion is not enough. You need wisdom, or you need renunciation. Because we could say that, you know, a very nice analogy I like to use a lot, that is another way of packaging all the teachings, is that the bird needs two wings, wisdom and compassion. So compassion is the point. Bodhicitta is the point, you know. So it's as if everything is leading us up to that. That's where we actually, the rest of it really is almost like preliminary to get to where we go to university, where we start to cultivate compassion. But to get anywhere near that, we've got to do the first stages. As compassion is not enough, you need wisdom, or you need renunciation. So renunciation maybe is a better one to talk about, and karma is included in that. So if we think of compassion, you know, what's compassion? And compassion leads to bodhicitta. We use all these words a bit interchangeably, but technically speaking, compassion is not bodhicitta. It leads to bodhicitta. It goes towards bodhicitta, you know. So compassion is what? I think the definition is something like the thought, when you see a person suffering, you think, oh my goodness, look at that suffering. You empathize with their suffering. And it's a thought, I wish they didn't suffer. That's bare bones, the meaning of compassion. So straight away, to understand that, because we get that, we all have that thought, we all have that feeling when we see suffering, but to really get it clear in Buddhist terms, we better understand what he means by suffering before we can understand what compassion is. And this, where do you get that? Back in junior school. Well, high school, in the second scope, you learn about the Four Noble Truths, you know, Buddha's fundamental presentation, one of his first teaching, I think, about the way the world is and what's possible, you know. So the first one is that there is suffering. And then the second one are the causes. The third is, luckily, thank goodness, we can be free of it. And the fourth is how to do it. Very practical. But before we can go anywhere near compassion for sentient beings, which leads into bodhicitta, like I said, which sounds so nice and easy, when we begin to even understand what suffering is, and then get some renunciation of it, then we can see how intense it is, you know. So what is suffering then? Because if we're going to have compassion for others suffering, we better know what suffering is. So right now, look at what we think suffering is. We see someone being harmed. We see the dog being kicked. We have compassion for the dog. We see a child being harmed. We have compassion for the child. But what happens then? Immediately it turns into anger and blame for the person who did it. And that seems to be the way we have compassion. You know, we have compassion for innocent victims mostly. And unfortunately, that comes down to about children and animals, as far as the world is concerned, you know. We love to have compassion for children and animals. Why? Because we seem to assume compassion is for innocent people. And what does that tell us? If we unpack this, what does that tell us? Straight away, it tells us that we're all innocent victims. We didn't ask to get born. It's not their fault. Things happen unfairly. Isn't it true? This is why we need to understand the first stages, which gives us renunciation in the wisdom wing, which is the understanding of karma. You know, so for many Buddhists, they think karma is like this extra thing. But, oh, I don't want to think about karma, you know. Buddha's all about being mindful and everything, you know. Buddha's about this type of thing, with very clichéd ideas. But actually, if you really, I mean, first of all, karma is not unique to the Buddha. The Hindus have got it. But it's fundamental to Buddha's view. The way the universe works, as far as Buddha's concerned, that's described by karma, you know. And we've got these very cliched understandings of it, haven't we? It's almost like we use it as like some big stick, and it's usually referring to punishment, you know, usually bad things. Usually we think of it as punishment, and we think of it as about the bad things. Why do bad things happen? We agonize, why do bad things happen to me? We don't care about why do good things happen to me. We never ask that question. But actually the whole business of karma and Buddha's view, all of which here is the basis for getting to this one, is understanding this, you know, this approach to the Buddha of why things happen. And it's a huge part. To really become a Buddhist, to really be a Buddhist, to have the big picture. If you don't factor in karma, then Buddhism just is nonsense. It's just nonsense, you know. Because to factor in karma means you've got to factor in his view of the mind. Because karma is done by the mind. Actually, the word intention, the simplest way to say it, is really the best word for karma. Intention, meaning every thought. Because karma is done by the mind. Karma is intention, if you think about it. It means mental action, they think. They say it means action, I think. Then the real action is the mental action, the thought. Because you could technically say if there was no thought, if there's a mouse in your kitchen and you stomp on it and the little mouse dies but you didn't even know, technically there's no karma. How can that be? Because karma means the mind has to be engaged. This is why for the Buddha the mind is absolutely central to everything. It's the main player, you know. So the Buddha's simply saying with karma that whatever our mind does, microsecond by microsecond,
And they use the analogy of planting seeds. Every thought does count, as I said before. It sows a seed in the mind. Another way we could put it, it programs your mind. It leaves an imprint in the mind. It leaves an impression in the mind. It programs your mind. And it can't go astray, because your mind is nothing other than what you put into it, which is all the thoughts, which includes, of course, feelings, emotions, all this business, you know. Whatever our mind does. So basically the idea of karma, Buddha's saying, remember the mind for the Buddha. We take this as our hypothesis here, you know. It's not your brain. Your mind is not your brain for the Buddha. Brain does play a role, but he's not discussing the brain. He's not a neuroscientist. You ask some great yogi in the mountains who's looking at his mind, where his brain is, in a Tibetan maybe, he's probably never heard of a brain. But the Buddha would say you don't need to know about your brain to know about your mind. So this is first point. Take it as a hypothesis. You don't have to believe it, you know. He would say your mind is not physical. And it's all your thoughts, your feelings, emotions, unconscious, subconscious, the entire spectrum of what goes on inside you. Everything that isn't your body, that's your mind, you could say simply. So what goes on in your mind, as far as Buddha's concerned, that is the main player. That is the main cause of your happiness and suffering. Really simple. And Buddha says this is the law across the board that applies to every single living being. It's just the way it is, he says. It's just a natural law, like gravity, like botany. He did not make it up. He's not a creator. He's not speculating. He didn't invent it. It wasn't revealed him in a dream or a vision. He has come to it like any decent scientist from his own direct observation, and then he presents his findings. This is a really important point, you know. Buddhism looks like any other religion. You know, I'm a nun. We did prayers. Sounds like religion. But it's got nothing, you know, it's nothing to do with a creator. Buddha does not posit a creator. It's an unnecessary embellishment, according to his view. We don't need creating. His view is that this consciousness of ours, this mind of ours, is a beginningless continuity, an endless continuity of mental moments, necessarily. And that whatever goes in it, and we'll unpack this in more detail in the weekend, whatever goes on in the mind every microsecond is what programs the mind into what that mind will experience and do and say and think in the future, necessarily. Just necessarily. It's just how it is, Buddha says. It's just what occurs. So he breaks it down to something very simple. He says, you know, what Buddha's dealing with is happiness and suffering. What he calls this the law of, we can call it the law of cause and effect. But we're very good at the law of cause and effect. We're geniuses. That's why we can get 100-story buildings that don't fall down. That's why we can get a delicious Apple computer. Every time you open your box, it's perfect. Right there, you can predict it, and you know it will work every time. This is a law of cause and effect, and we're geniuses at it. Well, Buddha's expertise is in terms of happiness and suffering, because we really haven't got a clue when it comes to that one. We've got the weirdest ideas about what happiness and suffering are caused by. So Buddha's, that's his expertise. That's what he's dealing with. That's his thing, you know. So basically, in the third noble truth, what Buddha's point is, and this is like the second scope you learn about this in June in high school on the wisdom wing. Basically, what he's saying in the third scope, the third noble truth, is from his own direct experience, from his own findings, his own direct experience, he says that there is the potential in every mind of the cessation of suffering, which sounds a bit abstract. You know, it means we've all got the potential to achieve cessation of suffering, liberation from suffering. Every mind can naturally rid itself of all suffering and its causes. So indeed, we'd better be clear about what the definition of suffering is, which is in the first noble truth, which I'm getting to, okay? And then the second one, which are the causes, which is where karma gets in. So this is what Buddha's on about, getting rid of suffering, okay? And its causes. So even if we don't go past it, this is a shocking concept. It's an outrageous, radical idea. If we think of it as psychology, and you could basically say Buddhism is psychology, because it's about the mind. He didn't use that word then. He didn't speak Greek, you know. But we'd like to put it up into the sky and call it spiritual. But we've got to hear that he's talking about the mind. He doesn't talk about a spirit. He doesn't use that word at all. It's an unnecessary extra component that is not needed, he says. It's an unnecessary embellishment. We don't need a spirit or a soul. We have a mind, you know. But for the Buddha, this word is used, like I said, to not your brain, but to your experiences, thoughts, feelings, emotions, concepts, unconscious, instinct, intuition, the entire spectrum of our inner being. This is our mind. First point. Second point is not physical, like I said. Third, think of it as a river of mental moments. And if you tracked it back perfectly, if you had perfect memory, you'd know you get back to the first second of conception in your mummy's womb. And all you've got to do is to think, where's the previous moment? What's the previous moment? Well, if you're a materialist, you go back to your mummy and daddy. If you're a creator, if you're a creationist, like Christian, God put the soul there. But for the Buddha, neither of those is valid. Your mummy and daddy don't make you, he says. They merely give you a body, the egg and the sperm. Your mind, you don't need it to be given to you by anyone else because it's your mind. It came from a previous moment of itself. Intellectually, it's not a very difficult concept. Your mind's a river of mental moments. You just have to take it as a hypothesis that it's not physical and that it's like this, you know, in the sense that today's mind comes from yesterday's. Your thoughts and feelings of today, your being good at piano today comes from your practice yesterday. Your being good at anger the day before comes from your practice of anger the day before. Same law applies, you know. That all this bunch of habits in our mind, and they're our habits, they're unique to me, they're my personal habits. I put them there. And we come fully programmed, he says, with all these tendencies, if we can track them back to the first second of conception. We come fully programmed with these from the first second of conception. And where did they come from? The previous moment of that mind. And a few weeks before that, the Buddha says this mind was in another body, and so on and so on. So in all the Buddhist literature, this is all laid out very extensively, just touching on it here, you know, the idea. It isn't complicated. It's not intellectually difficult. It's just because it's opposite to what we think, we often don't like it, you know. And this is why believing in it has got nothing to do with this here. Let's just, you know, just sort of shove it in undigested and say, oh, now I believe in karma. This is superstitious nonsense. It's intellectual laziness. Buddha has no interest in that, you know. So we take it as a hypothesis, not complicated. And you need to do this to understand Buddhism. Otherwise, it doesn't make sense. So this river of mental moments goes back and back and back. And whatever goes on in that mind, it programs that mind. And then that will bring its own fruits further down the road. If you practice piano for 10 years, you're not surprised you're good at piano. If you practice anger for 10 years, don't be surprised you're really good at anger. But we have different rules for these different things, which is very odd, you know. For the Buddha, it's the same, a bunch of habits. So whatever's in here, the Buddha's saying, is the source of my experiences. And he narrows those down to really simple ones, sort of seems almost simplistic. Happiness and suffering. Happiness and suffering. Happiness and suffering. Necessarily, you know, so he would say, so suffering, let's get into that. In the first noble truth, there's three kinds, way more than we think when we see the dog being kicked. That's the gross level of suffering. That's called the suffering of suffering, when the bad things happen. And that's the tip of the iceberg of suffering, and that's about all we think of as suffering in our own life too. Buddha's got a bigger picture of it as well in terms of different realms, but even let's look at our own life. What we mean by suffering is when the things that we don't want happen, when the bad things happen. It's clear, isn't it? Even you get a pain in your knee, that's called suffering, because it's what you don't want. When the food is the wrong food, it's what you don't want. When the husband leaves you for the younger version, it's what you don't want. That's what suffering is. We call it that, but that's only the first kind. Buddha's got these two other levels of suffering which are really hard for our minds to get, you know. The second one is very depressing initially because that's what we call happiness. So if the first one is when we get what we want, get what we don't want, that's called suffering. The second one is a subtle level of suffering, and it's when we get what we do want, which really makes us a bit depressed because we think, well, what can we do here? We're not even allowed to enjoy ourselves because that's also called suffering. For the Buddha's view, it is. And the only way to understand that is by going to the second noble truth where we look into the causes of suffering. So the causes of suffering for the Buddha, and there's a third kind of suffering in the first noble truth, and that's even more subtle, more abstract for our mind. That's called all-pervasive suffering. We won't even go there, you know? So when we come to the second noble truth, the Buddha now lays down the causes of this suffering. And we've got to remember that the context for wanting to know what suffering is, and then the context for wanting to know what the causes are, aren't to make us miserable. It's so we can get to the third one, thank goodness, and now we know how we can get free of it, that we can get free of it. And the fourth one is then when you do the job. So it's extremely kind of inspiring, actually, you know. So the second one, he lays down two main causes of suffering. It's really not complicated, but it seems because we assume it is complicated. You ask a person, what's the cause of suffering? I mean, there's going to be 47 years of discussion about even what the word suffering means first before you get to the causes. And of course, in the materialist world, we would say scientifically, well, we haven't found that out yet. We're still looking. We would say this, wouldn't we? Okay, Jesus has his view. You know, the Muslims have their view, but we're talking Buddha's view here. He's very straightforward. And he hasn't changed in 2,500 years. It's the same view as then. He's either stubborn or it works, you know? And that's for us to find out, isn't it? So as far as Buddha's concerned, there's millions of causes for anything. I mean, you look at, you know, a cup. If you had to, or a clock, let's say. If I've never heard of a clock, and you have to write down all the causes that have to come together for me to produce a clock, you're going to give me a 100-page book. is it not? So many things have to come together to produce a clock. So many things have to come together to produce a tissue, a flower, a cup. That's clear. But when it comes to a flower, for example, you know, we know very well, you can talk about many, many, many causes and conditions have to come together to produce a flower, but you can narrow it down to two, can't you? Or two or three. Sorry, here, something's going on. Okay. We're getting there. We can narrow it down. There's millions of causes. Again, if you've never heard of botany, you'd have an entire, you know, massive, long book describing all the things you have to put together to produce a flower. But you can narrow it down to the main ones. And you can say the main one is the seed. What's this? What's this? A sunflower, isn't it? Okay, a sunflower seed. We know that's the main cause of a sunflower. But you can hold a sunflower up here for 27 years. You won't get a sunflower. Because why? You need the conditions. The secondary causes, the earth, the sun, the water, and a bit of time, and maybe a bit of care, you know. And we know, logically, you'll get a sunflower. Well, we know logically that's how everything is produced. Everything is the result of many, many, many causes and conditions. And of course, in Buddhist philosophy, because this is his trip, he didn't make this up, obviously, he just runs with it, Buddha. There's detailed descriptions of types of causes and secondary and all the rest. Why? Because he's getting us to understand what are the causes of happiness and suffering. Like I said, that's his expertise. Okay, so when it comes to it in the second noble truth, because here we're discussing suffering and we can extrapolate the causes of happiness, it's the same except as the, you know, different negative set of positive. There are two main causes of suffering. Just two. Millions of causes have to come together. You know, if Rinpoche wants to punch me in the nose, I would say, usually, if your normal world would say, what's your cause of suffering, Rabin? I'd say, Rinpoche punched me. And nobody would argue. Nobody would say, oh, that's no reason to be, you know, that's good. You should be happy you're being punched. You know, that's a good thing or something. We'd all agree that being punched is not cool, and we'd all agree the person who did it is the main cause. It's pretty straightforward. And if you look at the world, we can deduce that's the philosophy of the world. And it's the same with happiness, isn't it? Why are you happy, Rabina? Oh, Rinpoche was so kind to me. He gave me $100, you know. We'd all say there's one cause of my happiness and it's called Rinpoche. There's one cause of my suffering. You see my point? That's the philosophy that we live according to without question. It's our mummy didn't even have to teach us this. It's primordially instinctive. It's the one that our materialist world runs with. All our scientific views, all our psychology is based on this. But the Buddha has a different view. He disagrees with that. He says that he can't argue that Rinpoche's kindness, his generosity, his $100 doesn't play a role in my happiness. But all he would say is that's one of the secondary causes. It's a mere catalyst for my happiness. His punch is a mere catalyst for my suffering. Like the earth and the water are catalysts for the flower. We get this. Not complicated. So what are the two main causes of my suffering? I'm suffering, right? As far as I'm concerned, he punched me. Sorry, Buddha says. Sorry, Rabina. He's only a catalyst. The two main causes are both in you, baby. You did it. You're the blame for both. And I'm the blame for both the happiness as well. We forget that, you know. We want to talk about the cause of happiness. It's the same thing. Your past karma, Rabina. Your past virtuous action. Your virtuous thought. Virtuous intention. No, sorry. Your intention, the thought, the intention, the thought, based upon a virtuous motivation. These two, karma, intention, and then delusion. And then the action with my body and speech, which let's face it, are the servants of my mind, aren't they, of being generous to this mental continuum that's labeled Rinpoche now. Because karma's pretty personal. You can sort of say like that, you know. So the two main causes for my suffering are my past negative karma or past intention, and then motivated by a delusion. My body and speech carried out that the thoughts, you know, like the body and speech are the servants of the mind. So karma and delusion, two. And they subsume down to the one, the delusions. They are the main cause of all suffering, period. And virtues are the main cause of happiness. So Buddha's view is sort of embarrassingly simple, deceptively simple. We just think it just sounds like religion, you know. But this is his view, this is his own findings, and this is what we have to investigate. First of all, it has to be intellectual. You can't possibly know directly a past life. It's like a joke. No one has, you know, we don't have clairvoyance. But when we understand Buddha's view of the mind, which is that it goes to far more subtle levels than this gross level we have now, the gross level of our mind, as far as the world is concerned, is gross conceptuality, which depends upon the brain. But that's just the tip of the iceberg for the Buddha. And this is, again, crucial to factor into this view, you know, Buddha's view of what the mind is. And this is not unique to him. It was the Hindus. His Holiness the Dalai Lama, I remember reading recently, it was the Hindus who 3,000 years ago or so were the ones who began this wonderful, marvelous conversation, investigation into the nature of the self, which is what the psychologists are all talking about. All the neuroscientists are talking about it. You know, this is Buddha's... And Buddha ran with this. He came out of that context, and, of course, he continued the conversation in his own direction, which is now labelled the Buddhist findings. You know, he went beyond those ones. That's the point of all this. You know, and understanding this karma is a fundamental, fundamental part of this process to investigate the causes of who I am, you know. So, okay, past... Action, dependent upon a delusion, sows a seed in my mind that programs my mind, and a seed, being a seed, multiplies in its energy and then produces many, many fruits of suffering in the future. It's a simple, uncomplicated concept, you know. And why? Why? Well, analyze. We analyze when we do an action, you know. The Buddha's view of morality is very interesting. You know, we're so used to thinking of the, say, I was born of a Catholic, the Christian, or the Christian, for example, the Muslim, indeed the Jewish and whatever, view of morality, and this is the one we've internalized, and we don't really question it, and we need to, because we brought this into our materialist world. It's a dualistic view. So I asked a Catholic friend, a priest, what is a sin by definition? And he said, it's an action that goes against the will of God. So doing what God said not to do is what determines an action to be negative. And that fits if the view of God is the one that you're running with, if that's the reality. That God is the creator, who is the boss, who runs the universe, who made me, made the laws, so he needs to be obeyed. So it's reasonable that a negative action or a sin is what doing what he said not to do. And look at our human world. It's just the same. I'm in my mummy's house and she says, don't do that. And me being a smarty pants will say, why not? And guess what she will say? Because I say so. Well, look at our view of morality. This is how we all think of it. We never question it. And if we really want to be serious Buddhists, we really need to unpack this one. We assume, and this is the point, look at us. Look, attachment and aversion come out of this. We all desperately try to be good girls and bad girls, don't we? Good girls and good boys. And what's a good girl? Doing what mummy said. And we are desperate to be seen to be doing what mummy said. Oh, I'm a good girl. And we need mummy to tell us you're a good girl. In other words, we need the rewarding. But look at the punishment. When mummy doesn't see me do it, oh, I got away with it, didn't I? We will think. Because we don't want to be seen to be doing bad things. Because we don't want to be punished as a naughty girl. This is our view of morality. Look at our minds, you know. And this comes up with our, you know, which we'll discuss in the weekend, go into more depth about attachment and the need to be seen to be good and all this business. The worst attachment we've got. But this is our view of morality, and we don't question it. This is where guilt comes. It's like a childish view, you know. It's a childish mind. This view of Buddha's is really marvelous. He says, you know, he says, just like Jesus does, don't kill, don't lie, don't steal. But his reason is very different. It's just like, you know, if you go to your doctor and the doctor says, don't smoke, Robina, you might get cancer. There's no way you'll go, hey, excuse me, who do you think you are telling me what to do? And then you go home and you think, oh, well, he doesn't see me do it. I won't get cancer. What a joke. We don't think that, do we? We understand that the doctor's a wise person due to his own experience, has found it to be so that cancer is the result of smoking, so he gives you advice and you're so grateful. Well, that's the same as Buddha. Identical. But when it comes to morality, we get all childish and ridiculous. You know, we think it's somebody up there squashing us with what to do and what not to do. That's why we say, don't tell me what to do. It's just ego, you know. Buddha, and this is the point, we've got to know this. Buddha is not a creator. He doesn't, like I said, we don't need creating. He is this person who is like a regular guy like you and me. You know, probably cheated on his girlfriend, did the regular things that all you and I do. But from his own hard work, he came to these direct realizations about the universe and became an enlightened mind. So all Buddhism is his own findings that he's presenting to us. So it's up to us. And that's why believing in it is complete nonsense. It's like learning math, hearing about mathematics and say, oh, I believe in mathematics. Well, I'm very happy for you, but what good is it? You've got to do it yourself, you know. And that's why we're so lazy in the West. We'll say, oh, that's science. Well, excuse me, whose science is it? It's not mine. If I can't add up, it's not my science. It's a really important point. We say, oh, yeah, that's Einstein. Oh, that's science. It's been proven. Yeah, by Einstein. You've got to prove it for you to be your science. And that's the same here, you know. There's no use to you saying you believe in karma. There's no use to it. It's better than nothing. Better than believing in killing, okay? It's one step forward. But it's not helpful in the end. You've got to get inside it and prove it to be true and experience it yourself. That's where the changes come. So, okay. So Buddha's view of morality is very simple. His, what, you know, for him, a negative action is a dependent arising. It's a conventional truth that can be proven. Just do a survey in this room. We're going to have all the boxes checked, 100%. No, no, no. Do you like being killed? Do you like being stolen from? Do you like your partner being stolen from you? Do you like, you know, being punched in the nose? We'll all say no. Well, guess what Buddha says? That proves what a negative action is. It's one that harms others. I mean, like rocket science, you know. That's what a negative action is for the Buddha. It's a practical thing that's a dependent arising that you can prove to be true by observing behavior. Pretty simple. But it's very interesting. When he says don't do it, which is his first instructions in junior school of practice, if you want to begin abiding by what Buddha suggests as good behavior, to turn into the person he says we can become, which is an enlightened being, which is the very first stages of abiding by the laws of karma, you know? And why? Because we know, according to his view, negative actions produce suffering. And hey, I'm sick of suffering. Positive actions produce happiness. And yes, please, I want happiness. So his first instruction is don't kill. Don't badmouth. Don't this. Don't that. Don't jump on the wrong partner. Few things. Seven only of body and speech. Not that complicated. Seven little baby things. Three of the body and four of the speech. Then there's three more of the mind. Beginning of working on the mind. But pretty simple instructions. Pretty simple advice. Why, though? That's the point. Why? Not first because it harms another. No, that's not the reason he exhorts us not to do it. The first, he would define an action as negative, as one that harms another, but the reason he exhorts us not to do it first, and this is huge, and we don't go anywhere near this one. This is huge already. Before we get anywhere near compassion, we're heading to compassion, okay? We've got to do this one first, and the reason he says don't kill, because guess what, Robina? That will harm you, baby. And we don't get this one. We think of morality as all about others. But until we get this, and this is my point here, this is the wisdom wing, until we get the nuts and bolts of karma, delusions, the mind, how it works, what suffering is, and become revolted with suffering, disgusted by suffering, have renunciation. We cannot possibly have valid compassion. It's impossible. It's too advanced for us. That's why we've got to do this first start, which is like we call it in the West, we'd call it compassion for yourself. We've got to know what it is that causes me suffering. We almost feel embarrassed to think this, you know. But until we get involved in this, until we become disgusted by our delusions and our negative karma, which takes time for us. That's why it's got nothing to do with punishment, nothing to do with reward. There's no concept like that in Buddhism. We've got to listen to it and think about it carefully and really get inside our own mind, you know. And this is the first stage. It's not even worry about the mind, just your behavior. Don't kill, don't lie, don't steal, don't this, don't do that. Why? Buddha says, because, sweetheart, it will harm you. So we should unpack that. Why does my doing negative actions harm me? We ought to look at it logically, analyze it, unpack it, not just believe it vaguely as some good idea, you know, which is what we mostly do. So far, so good? All right? Any questions before I carry on? No questions. Oh, but, okay, let's finish this one. Where? Where? I can't see your hand. Oh, yes.
Can you just real quick clarify for us the basis of motivation for good karma?
I'll get into the negative ones first, then we can just extrapolate. It's easy. But let's go into it now. We'll do exactly this point. Thank you. You're anticipating the point. So let's look at what it is that goes on when we do a negative action, and we can extrapolate a positive action, exactly the same idea, once we get this one clear, okay? So look at a negative action. So I'll use the one of the mouse in the kitchen. Very simple, you know. A negative action, remember, is defined as one that harms another. An action here meaning one you do with your body and your speech. It's a complete action. It's got the intention, it's got the object, like the mouse, the action, and the result, the end result, dead mouse. Roughly speaking, there's more to it than that, but roughly speaking, those four factors would determine an action as being what they call a complete action, which will leave a seed in the mind that will multiply and then ripen in the future as types of rebirth. This is how Buddha talks. Okay, let's look, unpack what goes on when we do an action that's labeled negative and what it is that determines the karmic result of that action. Just saying, oh, it's just not good to kill isn't enough. It's just too lazy, you know? So let's analyze it. And this is also proving dependent arising and emptiness. It's not set in stone that killing is negative. How can it be? Is it dependent arising? Okay, so there's a mouse in my kitchen. And I'll go, oh my God, disgusting mice, must kill it, kill, right? But if you, let's say you're in the house and you're a nice person, you'll go, and I'll say, oh, I can't stand mice, I must kill the mouse, I'll say. That's the intention, right? That's the first one, isn't it? Intention. The thought, I will kill the mouse. Thought, I will kill the mouse. And you'll go, Robina, what do you want to kill a mouse for? And I'll go, oh, okay, then that's interesting. Well, I can't stand mice, what do you think? Now, that's the motivation, isn't it? So, packed underneath intention, so tight that we never even question it, is a motivation, or we'd call it a reason. We'd say that in the West, a reason for killing the mouse. What do you want to kill a mouse for? I can't stand mice. Well, what's that called? That's called anger. For the Buddha, in Buddha psychology, you've got three main ones, basically. You've got, you know, if I want to cook the mouse legs because I'm attached to mouse legs, I'll kill it very nicely, won't I? So I won't muss up its legs because I'm attached to eating the mouse. That's the reason I kill the mouse there, that's attachment. The reason you kill a mouse, and most people on this earth kill each other, look at the world, people, is anger, aversion. And what's aversion? The response when your attachment doesn't get what it wants. I can't stand the thought of this, you know, ugly mouse in my kitchen. So attachment to my mouse-free kitchen causes me to have anger, therefore the thought, because it's our culture, kill the mouse. So first is intention. Underneath it is the reason, motivation, because of aversion. It's called aversion. So just right there, look at that. Right there, look at that. That tells us the main character of an action when I do it that causes it to be negative when I do it. Therefore causes me to pollute my mind. And what pollutes my mind is the anger, isn't it? Right there, the anger that propels me to want to harm the mouse. Now you might have a mouse and you see it harmed, but you are full of compassion. Oh my God, the poor little mouse, you might say. And then like a lot of people in this West, in the Western world, will go, best to kill the mouse. But look at your motivation, completely different from mine. Right there you can see the difference. Even the intention is the same. To, you know, I will kill the mouse and you'll kill the mouse. Look at the difference. And that's the point here. The motivation behind it. This is especially the Mahayana view. The motivation is the main thing that determines the character of the action that you do that will ripen in the future as experiences for you, you know? Is that a stretch or a hand? Okay, good, darling. Are we clear here? And the trouble is we never notice the motivation because it's just the intention and the motivation are so linked. You see the food, you shove it in the mouth, you don't even notice the motivation. Well, it's logical the motivation is attachment, you know. So what runs us, and this is what we'll go into in depth in the weekend, as Buddha says, attachment runs the show, you know, basically. It's motivation for mostly everything we do, you know. So here, though, we're looking at what determines an action to be negative, one that harms another. It is a negative action, generally speaking, that I kill the mouse, but why it's negative when I do it? Isn't, in a tick, hold it, perfect, is not the mere fact that I kill it. It's my reason for killing. And that anger is what's suffused, my mind is suffused with anger, isn't it? And that's what causes it to be negative. That's the main one. There's other factors as well, of course. You have such compassion, you're in tears. But you know, you mistakenly think, the Buddha would suggest, that killing the mouse will stop its suffering. But look at you only want to help the mouse. So that proves the killing, even the killing isn't the main thing. Okay, there's no, you know, you don't say, oh, well, I'll kill you with compassion. No, just don't kill, okay? But it's really unpacking it to see why Buddha said, why he says in the beginning, don't kill. It's for your sake. It's his own observation that killing, motivated by anger and the usual nonsense that motivates it, is what will pollute our mind, which will ripen as our future habit to kill. And because of the karmic connection with sentient beings, we create all this history with each other. We're going to meet each other again and keep doing the same old rubbish to each other. It's not, you know, karma's not random. And also ripens in other ways too, which we'll unpack in the weekend. So we've got to see what Buddha means by morality. And when we understand this, we will be so happy to hear that, you know, if you do this, you'll go to the hell realms for 72 eons. You'll go, oh, thank God warning me, Buddha. I'm so grateful to you. Instead of, this Buddha and his hell realms. What's he on about, you know? Just sounds like the Christians. I mean, because we hear it as punishment. We are so instinctively ingrained with the view of punishment, this dualistic view. That's why we've got to be intelligent and unpack what this means. And it's just like the one of smoking. You know, you see movies of a person who's got cancer and their throat is ripped out and their lungs disgusting. You don't go and sue the doctor for being rude and telling you you'll end up like that. You are so grateful for pointing out the consequences of an action that will harm you. This is how Buddha's talking, but we hear it in a moralistic way. We hear it in a childish way. We hear it as punishment and reward, which is the usual dualistic view that we have. So we've got to really think of it carefully, really unpack it. And this takes time, you know, because it's so instinctive in us to have this childish view of morality. Okay, so ask a question. Yes, sweetheart.
Ourselves about our real intentions.
Well, of course, dear, we're deluded as anything. We're complete peanuts. We haven't got a clue about our minds. We don't even look at our minds. As Lama Zopa says, normal people don't even know their minds play a role. Of course, dear, but we've got to change. And Buddha's giving us the methods, for God's sake. Of course we do. We're total peanuts. But he's giving us the methods for how to see our minds. That's what he's on about. That's his job. That's what Buddhism is. It's this marvelous, amazing, clear, precise presentation of how to change this nonsense, deluded habit of being ignorant and lying to ourselves and cheating ourselves. That's what Buddhism is. Do you see what I'm saying? Yeah. Yes.
So if we delude ourselves into thinking we are killing the mouse for a pure intention to, say, protect our family, is the same negative?
Well, okay, I wouldn't say it's so deluded, because it's true. If you're sitting there with rage and really hate mice, but then pretend something else, then you're called pretending. But my feeling is people do kill. It is you've got to be honest, it is aversion in most of us. Even it's aversion, right? Because if your cat did caca in the kitchen, you wouldn't just go kill the cat because you're attached to your cat. So we have to see, we analyse like that and we'll know it is our aversion. But a mouse is dirty. Well, so is a cat. I don't believe a cat's any less dirty than a mouse, but because we're attached to our cat, we don't mind, you know. So we've got to see our foolishness when it comes to this. So that means we've got to have a lot more honesty. And so then we can really realise it mainly is aversion. So for the same reason, please, you know, clean the cat caca up, but don't necessarily kill it. Same with the mouse, maybe, you know. Do you see what I'm saying? Does that make sense? There's lots of things going on in our mind, and the key thing the Buddha's on about is seeing what is going on in the mind now and slowly changing it. This is the point, which really is the hard job. It's the hardest job we'll ever do. Do you see? Because, the first thing here, too, for the Buddha, if you want to take one instruction, just one instruction that will somehow get the essence of all of Buddhism, and that is don't harm a sentient being. And the reason is because that'll harm us. So it's protecting us and others. It's the most essential practice. And that's really what's behind the fundamental, all the instructions in Buddhism based both on compassion, but also on compassion for ourselves. Because not harming others, at least having the intention to refrain from harming a living being, is the way to protect yourself and to not harm others, which is pretty marvellous. But you've got to see the logic of it, not just some kind of moralistic statement, you know. Do you see? Because we're unpacking it and seeing what's in our mind, the aversion, the jealousy, the anger. And in our normal world, that's considered healthy. It's considered good and okay to be angry. But the Buddha's point is everything we think has an effect on us. Do you see what I'm saying? So to have this kind of integrity, to want to look into our minds to see how I am producing myself, which gets us past guilt, gets us past shame, gets us past blame, but it really takes time. Do you see what I'm saying? Someone else? Yes?
What about unintentioned actions that cause harm?
Sure, unintended, we're doing it all the time. We're probably killing a million sentient beings a day. Under our arms like a zoo. Driving, just forget the driving down the road where it's fairly evident you're killing creatures, but just breathing in. Buddha would say there's not an atom of space you won't find sentient beings. So we're breathing in creatures, they're living in our body, under our armpit, we're walking on them. So Buddha says just existing we're harming sentient beings, and that's why the very first thought is to at least have the intention, like a light that guides us in our life, a genuine wish not to harm. And this is the power of intention, which is the beginning of the meaning of karma. This will slowly cause us to start becoming awake and noticing harming and noticing sentient beings and wishing to avoid, and more from there, but this is the starting point. you know, because we can't help it. So technically, when you're analysing karma in a very simple way, if there's no intention, there's no karma. I remember even Geshe Sopa saying, even if you are forced to kill and you don't want to kill, you don't really create the same karma. It's highly complex, actually. It's very nuanced, the meanings of it all. But the main thing here is to try and show the power of the presence of intention, which is the meaning of karma, and the power of the presence of the reason behind intention, which is the motivation that makes us do what we do. Understanding this is really helping us unpack our own mind and why, how, and the nuts and bolts of how we create karma, you know? Do you understand? Mm. Someone else? Any questions? It's only 8:30. Yes.
Trying to understand delusions.
Yes.
Is that like when something happens that we feel suffering, that blaming it on something on the outside, like something hits you in the nose, that the delusion is blaming it on external.
Okay. Well, the meaning of the word delusion here is interesting in Buddhism. Buddha's got a very simple, seemingly simple presentation of how the mind works, okay? We've got mental consciousness. So that's all your thoughts, your feelings, your emotions, all that stuff, right? So he divides the contents of our mind very simply into three categories of states of mind. Positive or, roughly speaking, positive, virtuous, beneficial, useful states of mind, negative, neurotic states of mind. And there's a bunch that are neither of those, but are necessarily useful, but they don't have the character of being virtuous or non-virtuous. Okay, so broadly speaking, in the ones that are called negative or non-virtuous, broadly, another synonym there is delusional. And again, we're going to go more detail on the weekend, because there's two main, another term they use for the negative states of mind is disturbing emotion. Another one is called a mental affliction. There are many synonyms, roughly speaking. And the word delusion is one that I like a lot because it's got this particular flavor which is really expressing Buddha's intent of why we suffer, because the negative actions have one aspect of being, when we look at negative thoughts, look into your own mind when you're jealous, angry, depressed. It's very disturbing, isn't it? Wouldn't you agree? Well, these also have this other characteristic, which we can't necessarily see immediately until we look into it, of being delusional, meaning they're liars, they're misconceptions. They cause us to have a fantasy of reality. We're not seeing things very clearly. We over-exaggerate the problem. We over-exaggerate the deliciousness of something. That's the delusional aspect of these states of mind. But therefore, more broadly, in this case, you'd say it is a delusion, Buddha says, to think that when you punch me in the nose, you're the main cause of my suffering. That's a misconception, he says. It's not looking at all. So that's one aspect of a delusion, where you've got it wrong. Exactly. That's exactly right, what you're saying, yeah. Yeah. Someone else? Questions? Any questions? Anything in particular you wanted to, you hoped you'd hear when you come? If I haven't said it. Anything, I know, I'm coming. Anything that you thought you'd hear that you haven't heard and you're disappointed? You thought you'd come for something, you got something else. Just in case, there might be, you never know. Any other, nothing? Okay, what's your question, darling?
You talked about becoming
repulsed.
Repulsed or disgusted at your delusions.
Yes.
And that is not aversion.
Okay.
Because you have a motivation to become a better.
I understand. Let's look at it. That's a good point. Thank you. Let's go into that. I forgot about that. Let's go into that. That's what we're getting at to get to compassion. So thank you for getting me on track. Okay. As His Holiness said, compassion is not enough. You need wisdom, or you need renunciation. Either way, so let's look at the renunciation business, this is the one. So if we take on board this very first stages of Buddha's, he says, don't kill, don't lie, don't steal. Why not Buddha? Because precious, it'll harm you. Why Buddha? Because it's motivated by a delusion, which is what pollutes your mind. Okay, so you'd say then what we're aiming for in the first stages, in the wisdom wing initially, what we're aiming for is to get what they call simply renunciation. So what are we trying to renounce? Obviously, we're trying to renounce suffering, but crucially, and its causes. So we've got to have, so renunciation of these two, that means the understanding of these two. We have to understand what suffering is, the three kinds, in the first noble truth, and that's quite intense when you get to the second and the third, because they're not what we think. It really demands looking more deeply into it. And then we have to look at the causes, which is crucial, Because we can understand a problem, but because you understand the cause of it, you'll never solve it, right? So the causes are absolutely vital. So when we have to understand karma and delusions, and that's where we really dive into the nuts and bolts of Buddha's view of the universe, the way the mind works, what it is, what a virtue is, what a negative one is, what are their characteristics. We have to learn to look at what a meditation is, how we meditate, because that's a function of your mind. You've got to understand the nuts and bolts of karma, what is negative, what is positive. It's a huge and marvelous thing you learn in, engage into, and the consequence of this is you become, and then of course you've got to apply it, not just intellectually, you start to look inside and you recognize that suffering and you recognize those causes, and so what you end up with is this incredibly self-respectful attitude of being revolted by this suffering and revolted by the delusions, because you can't bear the pain it's been causing you since beginningless time and continues to cause you. In other words, you start to take responsibility, because and this is a tough one, because the view, we know we're disgusted by suffering, we're all sick of suffering, but we all want to blame somebody else or something else. Even if you're dying of cancer, you still want to sue Marlboro, you know, because we don't know how to look inside. And it's a massive one to really come to terms with being sick of suffering. And we're way to go. I mean, Lama Zopa, I'm so depressing when he says it. He says, you've got renunciation. When just the thought of another moment of attachment is so disgusting. He has many examples, and one of them is, so disgusting, it's like using used toilet paper. I mean, it's a really graphic example. Now, who would have thought that attachment is like that? I mean, we hear the words, but it's so distant, because we live in attachment, the way Buddha talks about it. And it's a really subtle thing. Lama Yeshe said, I can tell you about it for a whole year. You'll never begin to understand attachment. And that's the fundamental delusion that runs us from day to day. It's the main cause of our suffering. And it's so abstract to us, because it's the biggest surprise we've ever heard. Who would ever have thought what we think of as attachment is the cause of our suffering? So we thought we've got to know what Buddha means by it. But he says, I can tell you about a whole year until you look deep inside. You'll never really begin to understand it, because it's such a simple word. We can spend the rest of the weekend just on attachment and we run out of time, you know. So that's renunciation. So way to go, you know. Way to go. But what it means is, because we hear it as sort of self-hate, we hear it as guilt, we hear it as, oh, I'm bad, because that's the dualistic view we have of virtue and non-virtue. We become fundamentalists, you know. This is disgusting. It's revolting. It's not that at all. It's like a really self-respectful thing when you realize all that food you've been eating is causing you incredible suffering. All that smoking you've been doing is causing you incredible suffering. And you have the courage to recognize that, take responsibility, and want to give it up. That's renunciation, except we're talking about mind here and actions. And that really, it demands going inside very deeply and understanding it really carefully and precisely, not in an emotional, moralistic way, you know. And the consequence would be, if you've got renunciation, you'd be an amazingly happy person. You'd be blissful. Like if you've been vomiting and sick for years and you've never known why, and then you discovered you've got an allergy to peanuts. So you've now recognized your suffering, but look at, you've won the lottery. You now know the cause. So you are, you know, you could say you're now really happy, because finally you know why you've been sick all those years, and you wouldn't touch a peanut with a million-foot pole ever again. That's what renunciation is. But attachment's the one we're talking about here. Way to go, because we are drowning in it daily. It motivates everything we think and do and say. That's not being horrible. It's just, we have to see it, that's all. So it takes time. Yes, darling.
I have a question. In your latest example, we're renouncing feeling sick because of the peanuts and then saying, well, I'm going to...
And you're renouncing peanuts, the cause.
So therefore, I will renounce peanuts.
That's right. Oh, God, yes, you have to. I mean, it's not enough just to know you're suffering. And then you eat more peanuts. That's what we do, isn't it? Because we haven't got the whole story yet. It's when we've got the courage. And the trouble is we're addicted to the peanuts. That's the added point. We're addicted to the peanuts. And so we know they cause suffering, but we keep eating them. But when we've had the courage to finally realize, I'm so fed up with the sickness, and I know that the peanuts are the cause. So, and having the courage. And then you'll be a blissful person then, because you've now got you've got some renunciation. Renunciation doesn't make you walk around looking all miserable. On the contrary, you are a happy person.
When you say dig deeper,
have to go and do the work, what does that actually mean?
Petal, it means you have to start realizing your mind's not your brain. Oh, good. That your mind is your thoughts. So, the Hindus...
It seems beyond that. The thoughts just come.
What, darling?
Sort of like an awareness of it, as opposed to just the thoughts themselves. So the thoughts don't feel just like the mind.
I'm not losing you, darling. Speak again.
It seems like there's actually awareness separate from the thoughts.
No, darling, awareness is one of your thoughts. Okay. Don't get all complicated. We get all very hippy-trippy about this meditation nonsense. But what do you mean?
Okay.
Tell me what you mean.
It's actually watching the thoughts come.
Who's watching them? What's watching the thoughts? What's the cause? What's the bit of your mind watching the thoughts called?
It's just like awareness.
Oh, what's awareness? Part of your mind, right? Excuse me, it's part of your nose? No. Part of your ears?
I don't actually even know. I'm not trying to be hippy-dippy or anyway.
I know you're not.
I don't actually know even what the mind is.
Well, I'll tell you. Well, I know, but I don't know either, darling, but I'm using Buddha's view as my hypothesis, okay? So let's use that one. Okay, what's your name?
Emmerich.
Who?
Emmerich.
Emmerich. Mm-hmm. Okay, Emmerich, thank you.
Sure.
So here we have Emmerich. So what's Emmerich? He's a person. It's a name for a person, isn't it? And the Buddha would say Emmerich's made up of two bits, his mind and his body. Okay? This is Buddha's view. And the body is the physical bits, which you got from mummy and daddy, and the mind is your own experiences, your thoughts, your feelings, your emotions, your unconscious. You with me? And it's not physical. Well, let's just take that our view here, right?
Okay. So separate from the thoughts, then?
No, darling. Your mind includes your thoughts.
Okay.
Consciousness or mind is a word you refer to the thoughts, feelings, emotions, unconscious, subconscious, instinct, intuition, the whole deal.
Sure.
That's your mind, all right? Now, you're sitting there with your body in a certain position, no doubt, when you do your little thing called meditation. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, very good. That's just your body, because your body doesn't meditate. Your mind does. So you get your body in a fairly conducive position, a little bit quiet maybe. You close your little eyes, and then you try to meditate on something. What are you meditating on? What were you watching? What was this awareness doing? You're watching your thoughts. Okay, good. So listen, darling. There's Emmerich. Now, our trouble is, this is where we get into the emptiness business, we think there's a little mini-me Emmerich in there who's doing the watching, and you kind of probably think Emmerich is watching the thoughts, don't you?
No, I don't, actually.
Oh, you don't? Oh, very good. Tell me, who is then?
I don't know who it is.
Okay, good, good, good. Okay. Well, let's keep it really simple. Let's keep it really simple, Emmerich. Okay. Would you agree that I'm holding a cup? Good.
Sure.
Pardon?
Yes.
Keep it simple.
Okay.
I'm holding a cup, right? So which part of me is holding a cup? It's not tricky, it's a simple answer. What's the answer?
Your hand.
Good. What part of my hand is holding the cup?
Your fingers.
Good, thank you. What part of my fingers? You can get precise, can't you? Good. Emmerich is watching his mind. His mind, yeah? You agree? His thoughts.
Sure.
His thoughts, yeah? Which part of Emmerich watches thoughts? The body or the mind? There's only two bits.
Yeah, you want to say the mind.
If we're taking Buddha's view, it has to be your mind, right? So your mind, just like your hand, Emmerich, is made of many bits, and they're called thoughts. Can you hear me? They're called thoughts, Petal.
Okay, so
awareness, as you call it, is just, if you like, is one of your many thoughts. So one of your thoughts, called attention, if you wish, is one of the many thoughts, is watching all the other thoughts. That's all. Not complicated. But we think there's a little kind of Emmerich in there. We think there's a little watcher, watching. We get it all complicated. There can't be. It's silly.
Yeah.
It's your awareness, which is part of your mind, your attention, watching the other. But it is attention. So, okay, my fingers are holding the cup, but my thumb does this, and this one does that, and the joint does this. They're all working together nicely, aren't they, to do the job of holding the cup. Would you agree? Same with your mind. Your attention is the one that's looking. It's supported by mindfulness. It's supported by vigilance. It's supported by this one. It's supported by that one. It's supported by all the little pieces of your mind all working nicely, which you have to train to end up with the experience of Emmerich watching his mind. Are you with me? It's not complicated. We make it very complicated.
No, all right.
So then?
It feels like it goes beyond that.
Beyond to where, darling? What's beyond that, please?
It's as if something else is watching.
Oh, yeah, because sweetie, very good. We think there is, and you think it's Emmerich, and that's how we all think, darling. We all think it's that. That's what the Buddha calls that's what the Christians call a soul. That's what the Hindus call the Atman. That's what we call the I.
So you're saying, what's watching me,
That's what we think is just a fantasy rubbish that we make it complicated.
And then how to go beyond that?
Well, that's what being a Buddhist is all about, Petal. Learning the karma, learning the mind,
My original question, you said you have to dig deeper. What does that mean? what is.
Okay, then once you get the. Okay, so if you want to play the piano, like say play Mozart, what do you have to do?
Practice.
Practice what?
Specifically.
Huh?
Mozart.
You have to learn the theories first. Would you be able to play with before learning the theories?
Probably.
I don't think so. No, you have to learn the theories first. Would you agree? You have to put all the conditions together. You have to fill your mind with lots of new thoughts called musical thoughts. Would you agree with that? Theories and ideas and Fs and Bs and flats and minors and majors, a lot of stuff. Would you agree? Masses of information. Would you agree? And you have to have a piano and then discipline and attention and all these other things and then practice and practice. Precisely the same here. To do the job the Buddha's saying we're doing, you've got to understand what his view of the mind is. You have to learn Buddhist psychology. You've got to understand what he means by karma. Learn all the nuts and bolts of karma. Learn all the theories and the concepts. Learn what he means by impermanence. Learn what he means by a person, a self. Masses of stuff you fill your mind with. They are the components you need to do the job that he says you can do of getting beyond the emeric nonsense and becoming an enlightened being.
So when you learn those things, is that also including learning the experience of it itself?
But that's what you put into practice. The theories is what you put into practice, isn't it? You see, we just think, this is our trouble, not necessarily you, but there's this cliched idea of being a Buddhist. Oh, you know, the Buddha's all about being mindful. Well, as Mami Yeshe likes to point out, a better word for mindfulness is memory, short-term memory, okay? Which literally is what it means.
Well, I tell people all the time, you can be mindful and rape somebody or shoot somebody.
Pardon?
You can be mindful and commit a murder.
That's the point. Islam Zobar says thieves need it. So there's this cliched idea that being mindful is being a Buddhist. Well, it's sort of like a bit embarrassing to think that. It's just one of the tiny many parts of our mind that is necessary to do anything. And it's neither in its nature good or bad. It's one of those third categories of states of mind that's called neither good nor bad. It depends on what you do with it. Whether you're doing it to create virtue, it becomes useful. Doing it to help people kill, it becomes not useful. So there's lots and lots of those states of mind which we need desperately to do this job of paying attention to your thoughts, you know. And so you go deeper in your mind. So this is where you need this marvelous technique. Came from the Hindus, okay? These amazing Hindus developed this amazing technique, which is this marvelous, sophisticated psychological technique that enables us to plumb the depths of this mind of ours, Emmerich, because we in the materialist world think it's just the thoughts, you know. But the Buddha, coming from the Hindus, has this extraordinary capacity, and what it is an ability to focus the mind, to develop this attention to degrees that we don't even posit as possible in our materialist world. And one of those many conferences that the Mind and Life Organization, been going for 30 years now, is organized with His Holiness and the best brains in the West. You know, these marvelous comings together of the Buddhists and the others. And the topic, it was in Cambridge years ago, the topic was the capacity of the human mind to concentrate. So there are the materialists coming up with their findings, basing them, of course, on the materialist view of the mind, which is it's the brain and conceptuality is its function. And they came up with like 6 seconds. I don't remember how they defined it exactly. There's the Buddha, Dalai Lama and his mob, coming up with their findings, basing it on Buddha's view of the mind, which is it's not physical. And it goes to very subtle, refined levels, way beyond what we posit as existing. And that the findings of all the meditators, that you can focus, concentrate for, quotes, months on end. So very different views of the mind. So you can't, you can learn all the theories, but until you have the concentration, which means go to these subtle levels, and it's described in 9 stages, and it's come from the Hindus, the Buddha uses it, you can't finally do the job. You've got to go way deep into the mind at a subtle level where you've got extraordinary sophisticated capacity to use it for unpacking and unraveling the really subtle, primordially held elaborations in this conceptual nonsense of ours that Buddha says we've had for eons. So way to go, baby. Are we communicating here?
Yeah, no, perfectly.
Thank you.
It's very easy just to talk about it without actually thinking about actually doing the work.
Well, precisely, that's right. I know, that's right. So way to go. We've got to start somewhere, though. So you seem like you're on the right track. But there's no Emmerich in there, so forget about that.
It's true.
Okay, good. So what else? Time to go, I think. It's 9:15. Hang your britches on the line. Yes. Didn't you say that when you were children? You didn't say that. Oh, we had one of those, you know, poet. It's hang your, what is it? It's 9:30. Hang your britches on the line. I don't remember the rest of it. Go on. Who else is there? Put your hand up. Yes.
I'm wondering what you would say about situations where somebody has what we might term mental illness and their ability to. Well, depending on the mental illness, it could be any variety of things.
Sure.
They're, you know, terribly depressed.
Yes.
Unable to curious the kind of morality that the rest of us can relate to.
I understand, yes.
And how we might interpret that in a Buddhist context.
I understand, exactly.
I don't think there's easy answers for, you know, very sad situations.
I understand. I'm not trying to be clever here when I say this, or even smarty pants, but it really is true if we understand the Buddhist approach. He really is saying that we are all mentally ill. He would have liked that phrase, I think, very, very much. No, I mean, and really, don't, it's not even meant to be a joke. Please laugh, but I'm not trying to make it a joke. That having, the trouble is, you see, okay, in our world, you're just describing a person who is not, like you said, the rest of us who can't, blah, blah, and we understand that. Every single person knows someone this way if we're not like that ourselves. So the way to put it in a Buddhist view, the way I say it, it's all just simply a question of degree. Because the Buddha's view is really quite insane, quite radical. He is suggesting that all the things that we think are completely normal states of mind, like anger, depression, jealousy, low self-esteem, these words are so familiar to all of us, right? And all of our models of the mind, would you not agree, would assert that these are kind of reasonable components of a reasonable mind as long as they're balanced with some of the good stuff. That broadly speaking, all our models of the mind would suggest that, you know, that being balanced in some good, some morality, some kindness, bit of depression, bit of anger, you're a fairly normal person. Would you agree with what I'm saying roughly first?
Yes.
Okay, Buddha goes way more radical, and this is why it sounds so insane to us. He says having any attachment, anger, jealousy, pride, low self-esteem at all is mental illness. He would have liked that term. He didn't use that word literally. But he's talking about the mind. In the mind, these are the ones that he calls the negative mind, the negative states of mind, that are the cause of all suffering over countless lives, eons of lives, period. And this is the stuff that we are trying to rid the mind of utterly and completely. This is what Buddha is saying. So, of course, we like to frame it in nice religious terms, and we don't quite hear it as simple as he's making it. But this is Buddha's point. So, first of all, join the club. We are all mentally ill, and I really am serious. So then, of course, we can see some people are more mentally ill than others. It's obvious, isn't it? So if you are born, and this is where we've got to factor in at least the Buddhist explanation, we can't understand this unless we have the view of karma, meaning to even posit the possibility that we come into this life programmed with our own tendencies. We have the same view in the West, but we think we come into the world programmed with mummy's tendencies. And of course, if we can't find, like this, you know, I remember reading in the New Yorker recently, the interview with the father of that boy who killed those kids in Connecticut. He got interviewed for the first time, you know, trying to understand his insane son. So there's no way in the universe in the West we can begin to comprehend, when you hear about this nice father, how this boy could have turned out to be the maniac that he was. So we mystify it in the West, and we are scared stiff of it, you know. We just think it's this hideous monster. I mean, the Christians would say probably he's got the devil in him. Who knows what people would say? The Buddha says he's got these fierce negative states of mind. We come the first second of conception, every one of us programmed with whatever our tendencies might be. They're not mysterious. And what we've got to do is, and this is the other point about looking into the Buddhist view, this is the one that's really massive. Because the materialist view states with absolute certainty as a truth that mummy and daddy make us, that our mind is the brain. Do you get my point here? So when I go to my therapist, where do they look for my problems? Of course, to mummy, to daddy, the genes, the chemicals, the DNA, the behavior, the events out there. So everybody is trying to look into this boy's life, the father included, and try to find the source of why he was this psycho kid who wanted to go and slaughter 26 children or whatever it was. Do you understand what I'm saying? The Buddha says that's impossible. You'll never find the answer in a trillion years. So where you look for the Buddha, this is where it's so outrageous. You don't need to look at the events. You look at the mind itself. The mind itself. So we could look at that boy, we could deduce without being simplistic about it, he had extremely powerful attachment. And what attachment is, and again, we can spend the whole 2 weeks, 2 days talking about it, but it's this powerful energy that drives us, and what it wants more than anything is what it wants every microsecond, and it's very fierce in him, which implies he's got this very powerful ego grasping, which is the root delusion, which is the very sense of self, on the basis of which is this fierce attachment to get what that self wants, on the basis of which when it doesn't get what it wants, it turns into anger, which we can see in the world can be vicious, violent rage, including torture.
culture, including the most hideous things that people do to each other, this anger that no one can get rid of, that people just go mad with this rage and anger. We can deduce this boy has this. I mean, add a few more components to it without sounding simplistic. He was a seriously mentally ill person, but we recognise all those. I've got attachment, I've got ego grasping, I've got anger. But there's degrees of it, and then the habits that are so deeply imprinted there, which he didn't understand. He wouldn't have understood. He didn't know why he felt this way. No one taught him. I'm just chatting away here, okay? Can you hear what I'm saying a bit? So what can you do to help a person is you've got to know their mind. Not just in looking at the bloody events out there, what their mummy and daddy did, and look at the genes. And even this little boy, they're all determined to blame the mother. Because people, we have to blame somebody. We're desperate to blame somebody. So they're all blaming the mum, because she encouraged him to shoot. So even when people say prayers, they say, oh, the 26 victims, they say. That means the children. Some people might say 27, including the mother, but they don't even want to include her as a victim because she's the blame. We've got to find someone to blame, you know? Well, the Buddha's view is this person, due to past habits of rage, habits of harming, habits of killing, not even knowing in himself, deeply implanted, habit of really lost in himself, locked away, then this poor little suffering mind, like out of his brain, you know. I mean, I'm just trying to be simple about it. Are we communicating at all here? So how to help a person like that? Well, you've got to first understand your own mind first. You've got to understand your own mind first and using this model. And this is what I find a bit shocking. Some of you people are Buddhists around here, maybe some Buddhists studying for years, even studying Buddhism. You keep buying into, I'm not trying to be Tom Cruise here, okay? But you keep buying into, oh, ADID and HD, this one, and oh, bipolar, that one, because that sounds more serious than saying attachment and anger. Well, I'm sorry, if Buddha's view of attachment and anger and jealousy and pride are good enough to get you enlightened, are good enough to understand, to get you enlightened, I don't think we need. Okay, fine. Talk about those ones. But Buddhists say to me all the time, personality disorder, oh, they've got this and that, like it's some kind of it's, excuse me, are we communicating at all? I got a bit excited there, but do you understand what I'm saying? We've got to learn Buddha's view of the mind. If you say you're a Buddhist, if you want to be a Jungist, be a Jungist. But if you're going to be a Buddhist, learn Buddha's view of the mind. Like Lama Yeshe said, I can tell you about attachment for a whole year. We've got to learn deeply what it means. Analyze exactly this one, that one, deluded this, blah, that, this components, those characteristics. And then through meditation, see it, you know, for what it is. Then you can help other people. But maybe some people, the delusions are so strong, the habits are so deep, the best you can do is protect them from others. Clearly. Clearly. Clearly, you know. Do you understand? Yeah. Yeah.
Who was most inspiring for you to get into Buddhism?
What an interesting question. Well, the first person I met was Lama Yeshe, my teacher, who was the founder of the organization this center is part of. Yangtze Rinpoche is one of his students, I presume. I know you are, of course you are. I met Rinpoche when he was a little boy. I always have to say that. Showing off that I'm older, that's all. I don't know why I keep saying that. It's kind of a bit patronising, isn't it? Because Lama Yeshe was at a Kopan monastery where I met Lama Yeshe. Where is he? Somewhere here? Picture?
All the way over.
Where? Oh, the statue. Well, is there a photo of him? Like a regular picture of him? Anyway, never mind. He's there somewhere. So I was about 31 and I'd been a hippie and a Catholic and a communist and a feminist and a Lord knows what. And I'd sort of exhausted all my options of who to blame in the world. When I was a Catholic, I blamed all the non-Catholics. Then I was a hippie, I blamed all the straight people. Then I was a communist, I blamed all the rich people. Then I was into black politics, I blamed all the white people. Then I was a feminist, I blamed all the male people. Well, I really had exhausted all options. So luckily I met Lama Yeshe. I bumped into this Tibetan person, and I think he was the one who grabbed me, got me by the scruff of my neck and didn't let go. I think because his behaviour, he was very funny, very down to earth, spoke in a very psychological way, and made what I'm talking about, which is what I heard then, made it seem doable and possible, and I was very kind of inspired by that, and that's compelled me to want to continue. And here I am, 37 years later. So far, so good. And I think we need a good example. It's a really good question. It's all great. It's like fine to read books, but we've got to have examples, don't we?
Yeah.
Lama Yeshe used to say, we're all dying for love.
So let's love a decent person. Let's love a person who won't let us down, you know, a person who's worthy of our heart and get good examples, because that really is the main function, I think, of the inspiration. I remember a friend of mine in London, she was married to a Tibetan Buddhist, and she was Jewish. She was always confused. It was just too complicated for me. I had no idea what enlightenment is. And I remember she'd been to the Royal Albert Hall for a public talk by His Holiness the Dalai Lama, and she was in tears, you know. And I said, do you want to be like him? She said, yes. I said, well, that's enlightenment. It's the power of the person in front of us, I think, that really does make the difference, doesn't it? But check out what they say, because Hitler inspired people as well. So be careful what they say. They might be wackos, you know. You understand?
No, I was just saying, I really appreciate what you're sharing, because part of, all the people you blame,
yes,
is really part of the awakening process.
Yes, that's right, also. It's true.
Sort of exhausting your possibilities.
That's right, exactly.
Inside of yourself, who's to blame for what I'm feeling inside?
That's right.
Find someone. And I was curious about the quality of the person that first really grabbed
me. I understand. No, for sure it was for me, Lama Yeshe. That's right, for sure. Lama Yeshe. Definitely. Yeah. Thank you very much. Nice question. Thank you. Yes, sweetheart.
Is there a particular reason why you have
put
your name?
Why what?
A lot of men and monks.
I think it was just pride. I didn't want to be called Tupten Kunsel. People keep saying, what? Rabina's easy. I'm more attached to Rabina, I think. I mean, I'm laziness. I didn't have any interest in turning myself into Tupten Kunsel.
My other question is that I learned from one of my teachers is that some nuns are taking the Geshe exam.
Yeah, that's right. They are.
Have you ever?
No, I haven't studied nearly enough. I would love to have, but it's a bit late now. I'm 70 this year, so I figured I might go and do the master's program, but I figured I wouldn't even really graduate until I'm 80. I think it's a bit old, don't you think? Because I'll be 70 this year, I think, oh, I'm a bit old. I have to wait till next life. Yeah. What else? Yes.
Do you believe that other people can make you feel things, or do you think you're responsible for your own feelings?
I understand, darling. It's a good point.
Someone yells at you.
Yeah, exactly, of course.
Is that you or is that them?
No, exactly. The general point in Buddhism, of course, the really rigorous point which we're taking as our basis for our own practice, which needs immense courage, is to know that my mind is mine and I don't need to be a victim of circumstances, which is the massive practice, and it's the essence of the whole practice, really. And of course, we have to know our capability. So if you're a really fearful person who's needy for love and you're married to a bully and you're completely dominated by this person, it's easy to say the theory, it's you causing the suffering, but some conditions make it quite difficult for us, which is why we really need to have some self-dignity and to really know the conditions that we need to be in to support our fragile little human hearts, because life is very difficult.
Like you just said about giving your heart to someone who's worthy.
That's exactly right, darling. And that's the tragedy, though. That's the irony and the tragedy of all this, of the delusions in us. It sounds like it's cruel and blaming to say that I'm the blame, my anger's the blame. But the fact is, that's what makes us so tortured and self-loathing. And that self-loathing is what causes us to be fearful and to dump on other people and then to yearn for other people to love me and praise me. And then that opens us up to being whacked around, you know. So we really, it's like a vicious circle. It's like catch-22. To have dignity first, it already implies some practice. So if we are, and the world is a horrible place, I mean, it's very depressing. You know, I always remember this number, 40% of all female people on this earth who get murdered, guess who murders them? Their partner. And I'm not blaming being mean about men here. What that tells you is the tragedy of conditions. That we live in these ridiculous little houses thinking it's all romantic, live in one bed with one person the same time, day and night. What do you expect? I'm serious. You're just out of your brains, you know. I remember when I worked with people in prison, and there's some of the really heavy-duty prisons where they have what they call permanent lockdown, where they're in their cells 23, 24 hours a day, and this is all the gangsters and the troublemakers. And they're in the two-man cells, 8 foot by 10 foot, smaller than most people's bathrooms, with no windows. Of course they kill each other over the cup of tea. Well,
It's like beyond insane to think that if you're a needy, depressed, angry, jealous, unhappy person, living with another person like that. I mean, it's just insanity to show how ignorant we are of what we need as human beings. It's just, you know, even as children, I remember talking about that to somebody recently. My mother was an incredible woman, an amazing mother. But we had a chaotic family, a crazy father was a bit abusive and, an alcoholic. They had seven children before they could count. They couldn't keep up with the number of beds and we were poor. So we lived in this messy house with the clothes up to here. My mother was a lousy housekeeper because she was so busy trying to run the family business because my father was out there playing snooker all day and drinking beer. So it was like this insane asylum. I nearly killed my sisters regularly. Not because, so of course Robina was the angry one, because I had not even have an inch of mental space. Living in the beds together, two of my sisters were asthmatic. I tried to suffocate them with pillows because I was going crazy. So that's understandable. Then because I was naughty when I was 12 trying to get the boys, it was the time of Elvis, and I stole my mother's high heels and I wore lippy and earrings and a full skirt. I was 12, I think, walking up and down trying to seduce Tony Kincotta, the 16-year-old greengrocer's son. Well, my mother found out, so she completely panicked and sent me off to boarding school. From the moment I went to boarding school, the same convent that I was educated at, I suddenly had my own bed, I had discipline, I went to mass every morning. Overnight, I transformed. What changed was the conditions. Conditions are immense. So Buddha says the mind is everything, but excuse me, give yourself proper conditions so that the best part of you can come out. And this already implies some self-respect, but our trouble is we're so bottomless pit for other people to love us. We'll grovel in the dirt to get praise, That's the irony of attachment. The worst attachment we have is attachment to what other people think of us because we have no self-respect. This is the tragedy of the delusions and suffering. So it's difficult. But have good conditions. Please. Get your own bedroom, please. At least. Be like the French aristocrats. They'd have their own bedrooms, Of course, no one has enough money, but this romantic notion of living in the same bed, I just don't understand it. I really don't. I never wanted to live with a person when I was into having sex and drugs and rock and roll. It was like putting me in prison. Oh. Even now, I get claustrophobic thinking about it. It's 9:03, time to go home. We're all different, okay? Actually, one of my sisters thinks she was slightly drunk one time. We get along very well. We never talk about things we don't agree on. We disagree. We're really good friends. I love all my family. But she was a bit drunk one time, so her mouth was a bit weak, a bit loose. And she said she thought I was borderline Asperger's. Because I don't live with anybody. I don't seem to care having nobody to live with. I don't seem to have very close friends. I don't have, all the reasons that I think are fantastic. She thinks are the reason why I'm borderline Asperger's, So I'm happy. And if the Dalai Lama is a borderline Asperger's, I'm happy with that. I've got in good company. So cheers. Okay, we've got to do our prayers and things. Back to holy. Sorry, flowers running everywhere. So we have to do a whole bunch. We have to pray. This is the Maitripa prayers and dedication list for today. Name, so we have to say some people's names. I will say their names for the results. And then we'll do some prayers as well. Where are the prayers? What do we do? What prayers do we do, folks? Where's your umze? What do you say? You're just not talking to me, you're just looking.
Terrified.
In here, do we... Look, I laugh all the time. Why are you terrified of me? When I told one of my friends in prison that I swear, he said, Robina, you don't. You're a nice little old lady. So everyone's got a different view, isn't it? Darling, what prayers do we do here? Request to the method, what?
29.
Thank you very much. Most helpful. Thank you. Okay, so we'll do, and remember these thoughts, we'll make these thoughts our thoughts. So these seeds, these marvellous, marvellous thoughts into our mind. How fantastic. So page 29.
I dedicate whatever virtues I have ever collected for the benefit of the teachings and of sentient beings, and in particular for the essential teachings of Venerable Lozang Dagpa, to shine forever. And then we can say, I don't know what you people do, but I'll just choose, all right? Then we can go to page 34, and we can say this wonderful prayer of bodhicitta. May the supreme jewel, bodhicitta, that has not arisen, meaning in the minds, arise and grow, and may that which has arisen not diminish, but increase more and more. And may His Holiness the Dalai Lama and all our precious lamas live long, long, long lives, because the world needs them badly. And so now we pray for these precious human beings. Linda Fox for healing. Beth Martinuk, Martinuk for healing. Ryan Martinuik for healing. Laura Maida for emotional balance and healing. Annette Keane for emotional balance. Judy Corsi for healing from cancer. Colette Sewell for healing from cancer. Davin Howard for healing. Jim Blumenthal for good health. Kay Baskaran, back surgery. And prayers for those who've passed away. Rio Cha and Bob Sugarman. And for all suffering sentient beings, countless who died today, who didn't expect to die today, you know, for those who are suffering, countless sentient beings suffering all the time, everywhere. And then we never finished to get to bodhicitta, did we? So I just finished with a thought, okay? This business of renunciation, once you've known suffering and you are vomiting at the thought of it, and now you know the causes, it gives you this enormous courage want to go beyond it, which means to get this dignity, to grow yourself, to become this marvelous being. Then you are now qualified to have compassion for others. And why? Because you see everybody else is in the same boat. And why are they suffering? Same as you, baby. Their karma and their delusions. So that means you have even more compassion for the wackos, more compassion for the precious boy who killed those 26 people because he was out of his brain and he didn't know he was causing his own suffering. This is unbearable. This is the compassion of the bodhisattva, okay? And then it leads to great compassion. What can I do to help? Which leads to bodhicitta. I must never give up benefiting sentient beings, because if I don't do it, who will? And then I'll never give up becoming a Buddha. That's bodhicitta. So this is all where it's leading, okay? Okay, good night. Thank you.